Do you want to turn your soldering from this into something reliable and beautiful? Unfortunately, before we start, I should ask you to sacrifice the solder bar and flux your grandpa passed down to you. Ideally, you'd sacrifice the 30-year-old soldering tool too, but that's less important. Here's the thing. After a decent number of hours of practice, you'll be able to use any crappy equipment, but for now, it's just a waste of time. The soldering process is almost always the same. You have your wire or electronic component and want to solder it to pad. You can place them together and flood it with solder, and accidentally you might get a good result, but it's the wrong way. First, you need to tin the wire and the pad. With this approach, you can be sure the solder has flowed nicely and holds strong, because intermetallic compounds forms as a result. And only after tinning, you should place the wire on the pad and melt the solder again. In theory, it sounds easy, but if you are watching this video, I assume you've already tried it as described and still got an unacceptable result. From my experience, the equipment matters. But don't worry, you don't need to break your bank account. The most important thing are flux and soldering wire. In short, good flux makes soldering cleaner, easier and more reliable. It destroys the oxide layer, helps the solder flow better and improves the bond between solder and metal. My personal best is Amtech. To be honest, I don't know if I'm using the original or not, despite the made in USA label. It comes in two form factors, a jar and syringe. I bought 100 brushes and used them to apply the flux from jar. I found this way much cleaner. This flux starts from $16 on eBay and $5 on AliExpress for lifetime supply, but in both cases it will be shipped from China. Soldering wire is the second most important item. The general recommendation is to choose solder from reputable brands. I'm using Cynel, 40% lead alloy with flux. They also have lead-free alloys. Lead is toxic if you don't know. It flows nicely and it's easy to work with due to low melting point. And it shines. It costs around $10 per 100 grams. Unfortunately, I didn't find it on a big marketplaces, but I'm pretty sure you'll find it in electronic stores in your country. And last thing about solder, don't use thick wire. 0.7–1.2 mm is an optimal choice. Third place goes to soldering tip. Yeah, I believe it's more important than soldering tool itself. Most people mistakenly think they need a tiny needle tip for accuracy, but in reality it's the opposite. When you have a large contact surface on your tip, you can heat the pad much faster. With good flux you can even tin and solder SMD components. The only limitation is space. You just need enough room to fit your tip without touching neighbor components. Lastly, the soldering tool. You don't need an expensive soldering station for 100 bucks. This tool and its tip have seen more than half kilo of solder wire over the two last years, and they're still alive. Surprisingly good quality for 25 bucks. But I'm not pushing you to choose Fnirsi. Cynel TS-100 and many other soldering irons with ceramic tips are great too, as they offer good temperature control. Just make sure the soldering tool power is at least 60 watts. Finally, let's have some practice. As being said, we need to tin the pad. The steps are: add some flux, wait until the soldering tool reaches the target temperature. I'm using around 300 degrees Celsius for small components, 360 for AWG 16 size wires and 400 degrees for large components. Heat the pad. Melt and spread the solder around. I want to emphasize the importance of heating the pad. If you melt solder and just drop it on, you won't get a proper bond, especially with power hungry pads. For a strong connection, both the pad and the solder need to be at the right temperature. If the pad is too cold, the solder will cool too quickly and create a weak, unreliable joint. People are usually afraid of overheating the board or component, but in reality they're much tougher than you think. Just place your solder tip on the pad and wait without moving until the solder starts melting. If it doesn't, the pad is not hot enough, so your components are still safe. Ideally, melting process should start in 2-3 seconds, but for now, allow yourself to heat the board a bit longer. If you feel that melting never starts, take bigger tip, increase temperature or help yourself by adding a drop of solder for more efficient heating. Now let's prepare the wire. Remove insulation. If you're working with multiple stands, twist them together to prevent frying. Apply some flux, don't drive to save on it. More is better than too little. Heat the wire and melt the solder until it becomes solid. Thanks for the flux, the solder should flow into the wire. Next, cut the extra length. It's a good practice to have the insulation as close as possible to the pad. Place the wire on the tinned pad and melt everything together. If you have any uneven surface or spike like this, apply a bit of flux and remelt everything. Even though I use no clean flux, I still recommend always cleaning the soldering area. Sticky flux can attract dust and debris, which may cause issues later. And let's not even mention how unpleasant it is to touch sticky PCB. Isopropyl alcohol and toothbrush do a great job cleaning it up. It's time to reliability test. As you can see, the connection is way stronger than a breadboard. The same technique can be used for soldering two wires together. Prepare two pieces. Place them together and melt. To solder through-hole components into a PCB, first insert the component legs into appropriate holes, then flip the board over to access the pins. Apply flux. Heat both the pin and the pad with your soldering iron, and then apply solder to the joint. The solder should flow smoothly around the pin and pad, forming a shiny cone-shaped joint. Trim extra length of legs. Unfortunately, watching a video won't develop soldering skill. You need the practice. But now you know the theory and have a video example. The best way to practice is solder real thing. Right now I'm working on a new video about assembling an FPV drone. It's a perfect project to boost your soldering skill. So I recommend subscribing so you don't miss it. For now, you can buy a few breadboards, different wires and components, and making at least 100 solder joints. Link to all stuff I used in this video are in description. Thanks for watching.